You're listening to IRN, the Inception Radio Network, Chicago, Illinois.
Extraordinary Phenomenon Investigations Council presents Epic Voyages. Come join us as we enter and experience the great mysteries of the world with tonight's host,
Carole Carle.
Carole Carle. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Extraordinary Phenomena Investigations Council. We are all epic voyagers here tonight as we travel to Wisconsin in the United States with some jogs through time and location as we attempt to follow the tracks of, well, something large and furry. And for tonight, we'll simply call that the Beast of Bray Road. But first, here's this, the housekeeping. This is all the ways you can listen to us. We welcome you to visit us at epicvoyagers.com for up-to-date information on exciting Epic Voyagers projects and how to view our upcoming radio show topics. From there, you can link to our Facebook page, you can follow us on Twitter and Instagram, and, of course, subscribe to our YouTube page. You can always catch us live every Monday night at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific on InceptionRadioNetwork.com. Inception Radio Network provides you, yes, you, with several opportunities to tune in and not miss a beat. This includes listening to us on your television set using Roku TV's streaming media player. On your Android, iPhone, BlackBerry, and Amazon smartphones, you can listen through your internet-enabled car stereo via Stitcher Radio's vehicle dashboard app. You can hear us on iTunes, Live 365, and TuneIn. And lastly, even if your power goes out, you can listen to us through the old-fashioned phone line. Simply dial 401-267-8300. We're broadcast, rebroadcast, every Friday night on Dark Matter Radio Network at 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. And if you absolutely cannot catch us on the air, don't worry. You can catch this show, as well as hundreds of our past epic shows, by clicking on InceptionRadioNetwork.com's archive pages. And I personally find this next part exceedingly cool, the Inception Radio Network interactive chat room. No need to register, just click chat to be immediately transported into the live conversation with some extraordinary individuals from around the world. And the IRN chat's also a place to ask your questions for our guests. You can also get your questions and comments to us by Skyping Inception Radio Network, all one word, or dialing in to 888-919-2355, or 888-919-BELL. And now, I'm going to break the form slightly, because we have an interesting thing. I just can't wait till the end of the show. And since we're all cozy around our cyber campfire, here it is. This is insider info that can't wait. Next week, right here on Inception Radio Network, and Friday on Dark Matter Radio Network, Epic's own Dr. Laurel Blythe Tagg will interview Epic's founder and president, Ken Cherry. They're going to talk about his brand new hot off the presses book, Mark Slade Investigates the Stephenville UFO, based on actual events. Here's a quote. "So you think you know everything there is to know about the UFO event of 2008 in Stephenville, Texas? Think again." Here's a Whitley Strieber quote about that book. "The Stephenville UFO event was one of the most extraordinary and important such events in recent history. Ken Cherry's novel explores the case and its implications in a creative and unexpected manner, chillingly possible." Okay, we're done with that. And now the person we all want to listen to tonight, our great here guest on Epic Voyagers, Linda Godfrey.
Hello.
Hello, Linda. How are you?
I'm great, thanks. And how about you, Carol?
I'm great, and I have so been looking forward to this. I'm a big fan of yours and of great
you.
Furry creatures. And I want to start, not that you are one, but you track them beautifully, you track them wonderfully. And your art, by the way, you started out as a cartoonist, is that right?
Well, actually, I had a degree in art education, and I started out as a fine artist and an art teacher, and I kind of made a segue into cartooning and got into journalism because I first wanted to do editorial cartoons for newspapers and just kind of worked my way into a newspaper via that back route.
Fascinating. And I remember a quote from the Beast of Bray Road: "If God didn't want reporters to write stories about werewolves, he wouldn't drop a pile of them right into their laps." And that's kind of what happened to you. Everything that began to come your way when the stories first came in.
Yeah, it's just strange. You know, it wasn't like I grew up saying, oh, someday I want to write books about werewolves. That never occurred to me. I did always feel that someday I would be writing, you know, even though the art came first. But I've always written, but I just never imagined. I thought it would probably be fiction or something like that. And even when I started at the newspaper, you know, I thought I'd be writing stories about quirky local characters and, you know, odd local issues and things like that, which I did, you know, and wrote many of them over 10 years. But I never would have dreamed that within, say, a month of my starting to write for that newspaper, that I would get this hint that there was something people called a werewolf running around my own hometown of Elkhorn, Wisconsin, and that this would be a newspaper story that would go national within weeks.
Right. And I have here in my hands a copy of A National Conversation, an article you wrote for the Smithsonian. The title is "Forget Football and Cheese. My home state should be famous for its shaggy werewolves and shape-shifting school teachers."
Did I say that? I'm not.
Well, you know,
I think they're paraphrasing.
Isn't that
me
funny?
There.
I wonder. You know, that always happens. But and which brings me to something that I also remember from Beast of Bray Road, and that is that your interest in doing so many interviews for the media as this began to break big was that you thought that at least if you were there, your story would be told correctly.
Well, that's really true, you know, because the one thing I've learned from all types of media, you know, and this started out immediately with the publication called The Sun. Some people might be familiar with that publication that hired me and this newspaper photographer to go sit out overnight on Bray Road with the chicken in the a supermarket chicken in the ditch.
Right, the chicken. And there's a famous photo of you with that chicken, putting the chicken down. Yes, a classic.
Chicken in the ditch, I call it. And, you know, it was there.
You didn't have fries with that, did you, Linda?
No, it was uncooked, so the fries would have been frozen too. It was winter,
right,
you know.
Right.
It would have been very, very, very unappetizing. But anyway, the chicken was still there by the next day. But of course, in the story that they printed, it was, "And the chicken was gone!" !! You know, and since then, and I sort of understand it because it's a bit sensationalist, the topic. It's not an ordinary topic. people sometimes don't know how to handle it, and there's a natural tendency to want to make fun of something like this that you don't understand, and that seems to have somewhat of a humorous aspect to it when you think of, you know, a dog or wolf running upright and all the jokes that automatically go with it. So, you know, I can kind of see that, but I always figured if I'm on the TV show or the radio show, there's some chance that it might get closer to being right. But I've still done that and been, you know, cut and pasted, and you know, the misquotes can be made. So it's just kind of a fact of life you learn to live with.
Right. And, you know, that too, I think a lot of people listening right now, certainly to me, that's a little kind of crazy making, because the idea that it's not a debunking, it's not even that, it's let's make this really humorous and ignore it. And I wonder if some of that doesn't come from some innate thing of, this is too frightening,
I think that's actually possibly true, you know, and I was a cartoonist, you know. Mm-hmm. I don't have any problem with a little bit of levity here and there. That's only natural. It's when it gets to just complete mocking or making fun of the witnesses, that's when I get really irate.
Yes, you know, exactly.
Sort of, but you're right, the books were what, the reason for the books was really to start getting it all down right in one place, so that no matter how wacko the website or the TV show or whatever got, somebody could go and look in the book and say, oh, okay, this is how it really was.
Right. This is the little seed of the truth that they chose to spin in this fantastical way, right, for, quote, entertainment purposes, right?
Right, exactly. I can give you a really good example. There was one.
Oh, yes, please.
There was one very, very good TV show. I won't say the name, but it was generally a good TV show. Mm-hmm. That I was on two different episodes of their series. And in one, what they were calling it, you know, a wolf or werewolf related show, but they said, well, just, you know, and the thing is, I have lots of Bigfoot witnesses too, right from the very beginning. And right. They said, well, just get us as many witnesses of both kinds, and we'll just talk about them both, and we'll talk about them as large hairy creatures, you know, but but just get how many ever you can. We got them together for lie detector for lie detector tests.
Oh, really?
And the thing was, when the show came out, there was no mention made of who saw Bigfoot and who saw an upright canine or dogman. And there are a lot of differences between the two. They really are very
right.
different. And so you have some witnesses talking about a 300 or 400 pound thing and no neck and a flat face. And you've got other witnesses talking about upright ears and little dog legs. And you end up, and so that is a lot of people who've tried to describe it on the web, I can tell if their only source is that TV show, because they have this all mixed up. Now, you can go read Hunting the American Werewolf, and you can see precisely
yes.
which ones of those people were talking, because they're all in that book. You can see which
great.
Ones were talking about
what
Bigfoot.
What's the title of that one again, Linda?
That was my second book. It's called Hunting the American Werewolf.
Hunting the American Werewolf, and that would be available Amazon, I'm guessing?
Yeah, it's still in print,
okay.
still available.
Good.
Yeah, still out there. So, but you can look at that book and see exactly which ones were Bigfoot, and the witnesses were extremely clear and extremely adamant as to which one that it saw, because I was kind of cherry picking really good sightings where they had a super wonderful look either in the daytime or close up or, you know, 10 feet away in the headlights, and great witnesses and credible people. They all, by the way, passed their polygraph with flying colors. Absolutely
wow.
no problem, which astounded the producers. Yeah.
Really?
So yeah, they were expecting
was that mentioned in the show that
them,
they
know,
all
would
passed?
Be found, you know, not to be credible, but they all showed no evidence of deception in any of their statements.
Fascinating. Yeah. Oh, I like that. You know, we Westerners, I guess, need some sort of something that, you know, like a lab result, like a, you know, a lie detector. What's a polygraph that shows that, you know, the little thing you can read? And I guess we're sort of keyed to looking at that. However, let's face it, although you and I cannot particularly even begin to suss out why someone would hoax something, I think there are as many ideas as why that would happen as there are hoaxers.
Yeah, you know, and that's something that I don't shy away from. if there's a hoax, bring it on. I want to know about it, and I would love to expose it. And actually, that's happened. And if anybody's familiar with the Monster Quest show, I was on their second season. I think it was the final episode or episode 14, anyway, of their final season. And season four, that would be, excuse me. And we pretty much unraveled the Michigan Dogman hoax. Not that there isn't a Michigan Dogman, but a particular part of it that was called the Gable film that really wasn't
right.
had nothing to do very much with the Dogman, but it was labeled as such, and it was packaged in the hoax to make it seem like it was. So there were two men that confessed on camera, and the gentleman who actually made the film showed all of his props and everything that he had and how he did it, and restaged the charge at the camera wearing his ghillie suit. And the thing
is, the ghillie suit, right?
Yes, exactly. And people were saying, well, no human could have moved like that. It had to be real. But when you saw him, I mean, you have to remember, humans are vastly different. We humans have such variation in our height, our weight, our musculature. And this was kind of a short guy with very muscular arms and legs, very agile for his size, he was able to do this really fast, kind of weird-looking movement that was just himself, his natural. It wasn't, the Korean parkour style of movement or anything like that.
Right,
it was just how he was able to do this. And even though the filmmaker and I knew we were standing there watching him, and we knew that he was going to come out of this bush and come charging toward us, we still both kind of jumped a little bit, the first time, because it was just startling the way he was able to create that movement and make it seem like it was some unknown creature. But I still have people arguing every once in a while. Someone will say, oh, I know that was real. It's a government conspiracy. They were forced to confess. And, I have to say, no, sorry.
These
were real confessions, and people want to believe, but this was one thing that, just was not meant to be believed in. And I even, when we were at our house, just in case, I know that from experience that TV shows that are supposed to get aired, it doesn't always happen for one reason or another. So I took my own photos of all the props just in case anyone would have any question and of the gentleman.
Perfect.
And so, I mean, if anybody listening is still harboring any doubt, please trust me. It was the Gable film, so-called, was a complete fabrication.
Right. And no connection whatsoever to Clark Gable. Yes. No.
That
idea is just gone with the wind. Okay, let's throw that one out. Well, puns intended. Okay, yes. And we have to get to the Michigan Dog Man here, and I have selfish reasons for that. But I'm reading how Paul Harvey spoke of the Michigan Dog Man, the old broadcasting guy, Paul Harvey, and that's the rest of the news, or something like that. And he spoke about that, and people from as far away as Germany wrote in requesting songs about the Dog Man.
Well, the thing is, people talk about things like the Michigan Dogman, the Beast of Bray Road, the Loup-Garou. They're thinking that these are all separate, single animals, that each is its own unique being. But as far as I can tell, based on the 23 years that I've been studying this and the hundreds and hundreds of reports that people have sent me from all over the world, it's basically the same creature. They vary in terms of the same amount of variation, say, in fur color, fur length, size, that natural timber wolves and maybe dog wolf hybrids would vary. If you saw any sort of pack, you'll get some that are dark brown or black or light gray. Some will be larger, some will be smaller. They have differences in their own, personalities, just as you can see in your pet dogs, So that's where the variation is. The similarities are much greater. They walk and run on their hind legs. They can use their forepaws for, carrying things. Kind of crudely, they're
yes,
paws,
right. I'm just thinking here of the sighting of one carrying a deer in his arms.
Right, exactly. Yes. That's happened more than once. Or they'll be holding up roadkill in their upturned palms. So the one variation, which would be very easy to do just under natural selection, it's not even evolution, it's just anything that had that had the reason to stand upright. If you selected out the most successful ones, would probably be those with larger paws, and these would be the ones that, you know, continued on the practice. And I'm sure most of your listeners are familiar with how, you know, natural selection and adaptation works in that way, just to help adapt creatures to their surroundings. Right. So that it would not require any more than that, because, you know, 90-some% of the cases that I get do not involve any overt supernatural things, unless you consider it walking and running on its hind legs supernatural. And usually they'll see it. The closest that it comes to that is sometimes people will get this feeling that it's somehow communicating wordlessly with them in an aggressive way, such as, don't come here, I could get you if I wanted, you know, that kind of thing. Or it seems to them to be strangely unafraid. But part of that is because you're just not used to seeing the canine walking and running on its hind legs. Part may be in the stance and the body language that we're subconsciously sort of translating in our minds, because we're kind of hardwired to read body language of other things. It's yes. just something that is part of our natural
instinct. A vestigial survival instinct.
I think we are born with instincts that are kind of biased against things that might eat us. You know, we can kind of interpret those. I mean, even a baby will cry if something, you know, opens its mouth and snarls at them. You know, they understand that, and so. Other than that, they seem like natural animals, and they'll run away in most cases. The behavior, again, is another amazing similarity, because they may make a jump at the car, or they may make a fake, like, aggressive lunge at somebody, but then just as the person feels they're dead meat, the thing runs off. There's almost always some kind of cover there, like a cornfield or a woods or bushes, runs off into the undergrowth, and then it's gone. Once in a while, if they're out alone hiking or something like that, occasionally they'll hear it tracking them, or they'll hear the bipedal footsteps following, that kind of thing. But they're very good at being elusive and getting away when they want to.
And kind of like Bigfoot, they're sort of not seen by people who particularly go searching.
Yeah, that's exactly true. It's kind of like my friends who are ghost hunters will say, well, if you want to see a ghost, then don't go stand next to a ghost hunter, because they never see them. You know?
Interesting.
Yeah, which is, I know some, and that's not... to say that's a by and large truth, because I have friends who actually have witnessed what you might call a ghost. So, I mean, that doesn't, but it's a joke among the ghost hunters themselves, because they spend so many hours sitting in dark, cold rooms waiting for something to happen, waiting through days and days worth of EVP recordings, hoping to hear a strange voice, you know, that kind of thing.
It's really daunting.
A long and tedious process. And anybody who spends a lot of time looking for Bigfoot or hoping to come across, you know, dogman tracks or whatever, will also tell you that it's really a numbers game. They're very seldom where you want them to be, and if they are, they know you're there. If they're natural animals, they're going to have smell that's, you know, 1,000 times better than yours, and much better hearing, and they'll detect you before you can see them. In most cases, I mean, and a lot of times the sightings we have are those rare cases where somebody manages. It's the wind is right or whatever, and they manage to just, you know, take a creature unawares.
So in other words, a lot of it is depending on the drift of the wind.
Sometimes, you know, there are lots of different things. And then there's also something that a lot of longtime researchers have noticed, is that after a while, it starts feeling like really the ball is usually in the court of the creature. And those people who see the Bigfoot or the Dogman or the giant birds or whatever, it's almost like they feel that they were intended to see it. Like they were, even if the creature acts upset, they almost sometimes feel, not every time, but often I'll hear this, that somehow they feel they were chosen to see it, or that it was allowing them to see it, you know, so.
Okay. Well, you know
not
what?
Every time.
This, This makes me want to segue into, I was saving it for later, but maybe this seems like the natural time to talk about Carlos Castaneda, of all people, and Don Juan and the Sorcerer's Eye. The idea, yes, the fact that as I collate this and as I was reading your book, I noticed many cases where witnesses believed there was a stare down. There was an eye connection. There was a definite, you know, before the snarl and turn away, there was an eye thing. And so can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, and I don't know, you know, there's always two sides to the coin. Is it supernatural or is it just something an animal would do? And I can usually find something to answer to both of those. And, of course, you know, if you're talking about things like skinwalker, there's usually a Native American tradition that if you run into one, you don't look him in the eye because then he can influence you. So that's an old saying on that side. On the other hand, if an animal is trying to be aggressive and defend its territory, you know, standing at eye level and staring you down that's considered a very aggressive act in the animal kingdom. And it might be that that's what it's trying to do, is just kind of say, hey, this is my space. You don't go beyond here. You don't belong here. This is mine. You know, I've got the upper hand. And, I've noticed I've got a little dog, and when he's trying to get his way in something, he'll jump up on a chair and try and stare me in the face, you know, or on this arm of the sofa is another one of his favorite spots. So if we're sitting there, they can just look us right in the eye. And I think that may be one answer, the same sort of,
Right. I think you referred to it as a grab, right? And it's just an extreme contact,
right? And
with a contact, how about this? A contact with intention? Yes, right. With intention.
Yeah, they'll say things like it sneered at me, or it jeered, or it was a leer. I'll hear those three variations of that same kind of idea of this sort of insolent look, like I'm as good as you, or what. That's how people feel. And it's very subjective, you know. But that's how people, time after time, tell me they felt.
Right, a sneer, a jeer, or a leer. Well, it rhymes really nicely. And
it does.
I just remembered a neighbor across the street who referred to her encounter once with a coyote, where the coyote was so bold and finally came up very close to her. And then, as she put it, turned around with a screw you look and walked away. Just literally, just, you know, this real, almost human kind of a disregard kind of a thing. And this is interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, that's kind of creepy even, especially for a coyote. I mean coyotes are little guys. You know, they're really not anywhere near the size of these, you know, the dog men or the wolf men that are reported. But they can be very, very cocky.
Yes, and I'm trying to get through my notes here. I know that you've got all kinds of things toward the end of the book regarding how the reasons why supporting or not supporting various critters that could have been misidentified, and you know, one of them is the coyote, definitely, which is longer. But even if it stood on its hind legs, it doesn't have the weight or the bulk that a lot of these sightings report.
No, I mean, they might weigh, you're talking about something that maybe weighs 35 pounds versus something that is usually guessed at as 150 to 200 pounds. Mm-hmm, and I know that one of the official, quote-unquote, explanations for the Beast of Bray Road, one that came from our animal control officer, was that all these people, and there were, you know, right from the outset, well over a dozen, you know, more than appeared in my original newspaper article, that all of these people were just seeing a coyote that happened to leap into the air, and while they thought they were looking at it for a minute, they were really only seeing it for that microsecond while it was in the air, and then they transcribed that in their own brains into seeing something that was 5 or 6 feet tall standing up. Now, I'm sorry, but people aren't dumb.
Not that dumb.
You know,
it reminds me of the, you know, well, the UFO stuff with, well, it was swamp gas. Okay. Mm.
Right, exactly. Mm. And this, you know, it just kind of, I mean, that's a bigger stretch than anything I could have thought up, you know. It's just not likely. Perhaps it was possible that there was one person in pitch darkness who had a terrible view of it, and it flashed in his headlights just at the moment that it jumped up, and he didn't notice that it was in the air, not long legged. I mean, you know, even that's how you have to put the, you know, add all the and yets, and then to get it to work. And so the coyote just doesn't work for it. A bear is a possible misidentification in some cases, but there aren't that many bears around southern Wisconsin. One goes through occasionally, but not enough to create all these sightings that actually, they didn't all occur, you know, within a few weeks either. I mean, they had been going on for well over a decade, maybe longer, and actually continue to this day, you know. So it couldn't have been just like one mangy creature. So, but a bear also, if you have a good look at it, as many of these people did, anybody who's seen a bear run, it, you know, it just kind of lumbers on on all fours, and it's got a much lower center of gravity. The legs are thicker and shorter. It just doesn't, it's got a very different, it's got this big triangular head. It doesn't look like a canine. And if you see a bear, I've seen bears running in the ditch. My dad's from northern Wisconsin. I've seen them, you know, more than once, or out in the wild between me and the house, you know, different times. And you know immediately that it's a bear and nothing else, because it's just too different.
Right. Well, it was my mind's eye is saying that it's a bulk factor. They're just, a bear is just bulkier.
Right, exactly. Now, if somebody comes to me, and once in a while I'll get a report that says, well, you know, I heard something crashing through the woods and I could see brown fur between the trees. Well, that could be a bear for all you know. Mm. It could be a Bigfoot. It could be an upright canine. It could be a moose. I mean, it could be lots and lots. It could be an elk or a large deer. It could be just about
anything. Well, speaking of moose and elk, this is something just crossing my mind. Speaking of Elkhorn, Wisconsin, it obviously elk and moose are in the area, right?
Well, no, they were.
No.
Not moose. I think we're a little far south from moose, but there were once elk. You know, elk were a normal animal. They were kind of hunted to extinction. Mm-hmm. And by the time the guy came here who named this place Elkhorn, the elks were gone, but he found a large rack, elk rack, up in a tree and right where the town was. And he took that down, and that original elk horn is still in our city hall today. To this very day. But I can tell you what, they're coming back, because I spend a fair amount of time out in the field looking for tracks and animal scat, and I found one day right here, not too far out of, about 8 miles north of Elkhorn, Wisconsin, a beautiful specimen of elk scat, which is quite unique. And I had that confirmed by some professional identifiers that I was recommended by a Department of Natural Resources agent to use. And they wrote back and they said, yeah, you've got elk. Are you supposed to have elk there? You know, do you have elk there? And I said, well, not that I knew of, but it was definitely there. There was absolutely no doubt. So, and elk are huge, you know, and it had gotten around this area and nobody had seen it. And there were people, it was literally in their backyards. It would have had to have been in their backyards to have gotten to this spot. And nobody had seen it or had the slightest clue that it was there. And yet the absolute physical proof was right there.
See, that just kind of blows my mind, because that's kind of like an opposite. That's like a non-sighting of something that's huge that is there and people don't see it.
Right, exactly.
Wow.
When you have the scat, and here's the key, you can't have people say, well, you know, why don't you get, you know, Bigfoot poop or some scat from the dog man?
Right.
But that's only half of the equation. Unless you have the proof, the reason these guys could say, yeah, that's elk scat, is because they have a database that shows what elk scat is and the comparison. There is no gold standard for Bigfoot scat.
There is no baseline. Yeah.
Right. So they may have a big gooey substance and they have nothing to go by to say, yep, this is what it came from. So that's the problem with cryptids and their scat.
Right. That must be some of the stuff that Lauren Coleman faces on a regular basis.
I'm sure he and every other researcher that is, you know, out trying to find some sort of evidence that will eventually lead to proof.
Right, exactly. And yeah, it's an interesting thing because here we have people seeing something, and they've been seeing something. In fact, maybe this is the time we should talk about back to 1936 in the area.
Yeah, 1936 was the year that it's the earliest sighting of an unknown upright hairy creature that I have in this area. And the source was pretty good. This happened at a Catholic institution for the care of developmentally disabled people that was in existence actually up until maybe 10 years ago. And one of the Kennedy daughters was housed.
Yes, Rosemary. I remember that. Right.
Right. Rosemary Kennedy. Yeah. Yes. But it was a lovely place, and the campus is still there. And this actually is situated at a spot where there were quite a few Native American burial mounds and effigy or animal-shaped mounds. And there happened to be one on the grounds. And one night, the night watchman, who was a devout Catholic, I'm sure that was a condition for his hiring at the time, and also a former pro boxer, was out making his rounds, and he saw this tall, hairy thing with pointed ears digging in this mound, and he had just kind of surprised it, and the thing looked at him and then ran away. Well, he went back the next night, and he had a big, huge, heavy, flat, clumsy kind of flashlight, as such as they had in those days.
Right.
And it was there again, and this time it stood up and made a sound at him that it sound, and you can interpret it again either as because it uses the consonants that are normally in a growl, G, D. It sounded like Gadara.
Which takes us to another point, but go ahead, finish this, yes?
So you can see that it could have been just a growl, or it could have been a word. And if you look in the Bible, in the New Testament, in the doings of Jesus, when he was wandering around casting out demons, the region of Gadara was one of the places where he actually cast the demons from the man into the herd of swine, which then rushed into the sea. So, you know, it's interesting because you've got this religious institution and possibly religion-related word that it might have said, but then it also could have been a growl, interpreted as a growl. You know, the man heard it one way. Now, this man never told anyone except his wife, and then he thought that he was dying. He didn't actually die at this time, but when he was on what he thought was his deathbed, he confided in his son, who was a newspaper editor in Racine County, and had his son draw sort of a composite sketch at his direction of what he thought that it looked like. And this gentleman kept this to himself until my newspaper story came out, which was in the winter of 91-92.
Oh, that's a long time.
And yeah, it's been 23 years. And this gentleman, he said he was lying on the couch watching TV, and they showed that's the sketch that I had drawn from what the others said they had seen. And he said he practically leaped horizontally off of the sofa and, you know, was yelling for his wife that this was what his father had drawn. And he contacted me immediately.
Wow.
And I, you know, wrote about it, interviewed him at great length. We're still good friends. He's a very nice gentleman. He's an author himself. But this was the secret he'd been keeping from his very religious father's deathbed all those years.
Oh, so, for heaven's sake.
Yeah, so it's kind of an amazing thing. Yeah, and there have been other sightings around in that general area. This was in Jefferson County.
Right,
and
Jefferson County.
Right, that's very close to Fort Atkinson. Highway 106 that goes through Fort Atkinson has been the site of several sightings, including one by this man's granddaughter.
Mm.
And it was a daylight sighting and very, very clear. She's an excellent witness, and she said she'd always kind of somewhat doubted the family story until she saw herself for herself. Except what she saw was a Bigfoot. clearly a Bigfoot.
Oh, really? Now that's fascinating.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Wow. So, go ahead.
I was just going to say, if you look at the sketch, it actually does have some composite features of both. In a way, maybe that TV series, was right once in a while. It was sort of a composite sketch. It was hard to tell exactly what it was from what he drew. But you can imagine, it had been years. Someone else was drawing it. You can see how mistakes would creep in. But what this woman saw was definitely a Bigfoot. So, but she said, well, if one is real, then the other one must be real, was kind of her reasoning, which makes sense. If Bigfoot is real, why would not the upright dog man be real? If you believe one set of witnesses, why wouldn't you believe the other set?
Exactly. And somewhere you mentioned in Beast of Bray Road how it's very likely that all of these things are individual different critters, that they're not necessarily what people are seeing when they see these anomalies they're not all the same thing.
Well, that's exactly right. It's not only that they may not be the same species, but they may be just different versions or different phenomena. For instance, many humans see what we call ghosts, which are apparitions of human beings that we discover when they, walk through a wall or fade or whatever, actually human beings. They just really look like one. Perhaps some of these things are apparitions, and whatever it is that creates the ghost-like apparitions of humans,
yes.
Why could not that also operate in the animal world and create apparitions of certain types of animals, like large primates or super large dogs? We don't know. Then there are also the possibly ritualistically induced apparitions, or maybe they're more, they seem to be more than apparitions. The stories about creatures that are produced by shamans and really by earth-based religions all around the world and back through time have done this same thing, where the learned medicine people, sometimes they're regarded as witches by their own people, or people who are doing something not so great, are able to learn how to draw forth these I don't know whether to call them entities or exactly what they
energies.
Are.
I was thinking energies.
Yeah. Energies or entities somehow that can have dimension and weight and gravity and interact with their surroundings and do things. Sometimes they can go forth and run away and do things on their own. Sometimes they're sort of materialized over the person generating them, kind of like if they instantly donned a creature's suit, and then the person can go off and do things, usually with greatly enhanced energy and strength. So it's kind of weird. It's like they have this, they're more than an apparition in that case. So you've got regular solid animals that might just do things weirdly or be mistaken. You've got possible apparitions that could come from, who knows, maybe they come from another dimension or somewhere else. Or you've got possibly, human psyche or human ritual generated things.
Exactly. And that brings us into Native Americans and Amerindians and the idea of shapeshifters and skinwalkers.
Right. And this is something that I don't pretend to understand. And when it gets down to the mechanics of it, honestly, I don't want to know. There's a point where I stop. If I can get to the point where it seems like, okay, all of the people who report that they believe these are shapeshifters give these characteristics, and I can indicate that they fall into this category, that's good enough for me. I don't need or want to know how it's done. That's for somebody else. It's not my area of interest. I don't hunt these people. I don't look for the people. I'm just sort of interested in categorizing the information so that we can kind of see what we've got, And again, these are not the majority of sightings. These are the small minority that come into play with different features, such as, for instance, many of the creatures that fall into the parameters of what you might call a skinwalker, that they have these certain mm-hmm. characteristics, mm-hmm. are actually located around Native American reservations. They often will have red eye glow instead of normal yellow-green eye shine that a normal canine will have. They'll be reported to have, they're actually usually supersized, often as tall as 8 feet. Normally, they're very dark in color. Normally, they're like a dark black or brown, although not always. But they will also be said to have human-like shoulders and hands, rather than, you know, dogs and canines and wolves do not have actual shoulders. They've got They've got muscles on their what we would consider the upper part of our arms. Mm-hmm. You know, are look a little different on them. They don't come out of shoulders there like we have, where we can rotate our shoulders and reach out to grab branches or whatever, pick up a rock mm-hmm. and throw it. They're not made that way. They may look more heavily muscled in these creatures that are using their forelimbs for things they're not accustomed to. Mm-hmm. But they're still you know, just forelimbs. They're not shoulders. So you've got a more humanoid shape, you've got this larger size, the red eyes, the differently shaped, you know, hands instead of paws. And usually those characteristics seem to have some Native American connection and seem more like what you might call the shapeshifter or whatever the term is for these people. And again, that's as much as I want to know. You know, I've had people send me send me things like, well, this is the old, you know, the formula mumbo jumbo that you do. And I'm like, please take that back. I don't want that. I don't want to know it. If it's happening, that's for the next generation or somebody with a completely different aim than I have to do. You know, I'm a nice Lutheran girl from Elkhorn, and it's just not in my purview. It's not where I want to go with this.
Well, and now you said Lutheran, and so that brought to my mind the anecdote that goes way back, and I think is connected to Ambrose Bierce that I stumbled upon in Beast of Bray Road, mm-hmm. and that's the villagers where something was wrong, something was running amok, something was killing, animals and people, and they caught hold, memory may not serve here, Linda, you can help me, they caught somebody and tied him to a post in the village square, and in the morning, nothing was there. And so he said, well, you need to bind, Ambrose Bierce said, you need to, purportedly, you need to bind them better, and in the morning, tied to that post, you will find a good Lutheran.
Yeah.
Yes, I love
somebody,
that.
Somebody had actually, because I had made that statement about those things, and some very intrepid listener sent me that Ambrose Bierce quote, kind of to tweak me about it. But I thought it was hysterical.
It's beautiful. Yes, it is.
Yeah, I thought it was just a hysterical thing. So, you know, and Ambrose Bierce, of course, was quite the witty person.
Right, and also very mysterious. I memory does not serve once again here. Did he ever, I know he disappeared at some point. Was he ever found?
I'm blanking out on his exact mm-hmm. end, but I think you're right. You know, he was famous for the Devil's Dictionary, as it was titled, and several other things. And then I think that you're right, and I wouldn't want to be quoted on this because I don't know.
Okay.
My memory, if I don't have it right in front of me, sometimes the fine details escape. He was a mysterious character, but a very funny, dryly witty person.
Yes. Yes, and of course, after all, you are a compendium of information in this area, and so, of course, not all the stuff you know is exactly in front of you. I wanted to talk about something to do with the Native Americans a little bit more, about the hairy heart beings and the Cree and the ancients, and George Nelson's Cree informant. Is this ringing a bell? Okay.
Yes, definitely. It really stunned me when I was first starting to research these things, and I realized there were actually quite a contingent. There was George Nelson, there was Henry Schoolcraft, people who were very early on involved with the Native Americans. That they were dealing with them as fur trappers. Jesuits were coming to convert them. You know, all kinds of reasons that they were having first contact. And usually
right. And I just want to interrupt one second for our listeners who may not be aware of like a time frame for this. I think 1823 is George Nelson's book. Is that, I believe, the date? In
right.
fact, I'm yes, yes.
Right. But
okay.
some of the, I mean,
so
some of these
the time
contacts
frame. Okay.
go back to
go
the
ahead.
1600s.
Sorry. Okay, go. Oh, wow.
Know, but yeah, he was, George Nelson was living among them, you know, around the very early 1800s and was mm-hmm. very interested in recording very many of their legends and their religious beliefs and that sort of thing. So as it turned out, several of them would tell him about these other people that lived in the forest, that used to live in the forest. They were called the hairy heart beings or hairy breast beings, mm-hmm. which really sound to me more like Bigfoot than Dogman.
Yes.
And mm-hmm. it kind of parallels, if you go over to, you know, Washington State and Oregon, the Native Americans there also have legends of these huge hairy forest people or hairy man. There are different names for them that all sort of imply a giant hair-covered person of some type that
right,
these people regarded as other tribes or other peoples. And the hairy heart beings, George Nelson was told that these Indians had gone to war against these people because they were always coming and taking away their women. In some cases, they were cannibals. I know, you know, in the West Coast, those large beings were considered to be cannibalistic. So all of that sort of gives you the idea that maybe there was this actual sort of hybrid, they seem primitive, and yet they were viewed as people. So who knows exactly what they were, but some kind of real race of beings. Now, the hairy hearts, there were supposed to be a couple of surviving bands of them somewhere, you know, and the Native Americans.
Right, I think there was a mention.
Very vague about that part.
Right, a reference to one band in the United States and one in Canada and another abroad.
Right. Right, exactly. Yeah, they told them that there were still some around, you know, and you can assume if they were kidnapping the women, maybe it sounds like they were able to possibly interbreed, and which would mean that they were very closely related to humans for that to
right,
even
genetically,
be possible.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, so that there probably were, you know, hybrid descendants between them, and I just think that is fascinating to find these things in the very old records where you're getting some of the earliest statements before our indigenous people were, you know, kind of carted away from their own lands and made to go to English-speaking schools and forced to forget a lot of their old things.
Right, right. And the antiquity of that information, the word that occurs to me is uncontaminated. It's before people were even subconsciously and honestly influenced by any kind of media, et cetera, films, blah, blah, written stuff. So there's somehow an authenticity to that.
Right. And, I mean, Europeans coming to this country in those days actually would have had things like werewolves on their mind, or maybe the wild man of the woods, which was something like, or the Wodewos, which was sort of a big hairy man. So they may have actually had these ideas. It wasn't totally uncontaminated on their side.
Ah.
Because we had these, witch and werewolf trials. And
Right, of course.
And the wild man of the woods was something that was actually a very popular court figure. They would wear something that was sort of like a ghillie suit, a homemade ghillie suit back in those days, and have parties where this was the featured guest of honor and that kind of thing. So the
right,
and
I'm remembering
the cathedrals. The images.
Exactly, and I'm remembering some tragic incident regarding the men dressed as they were wearing pitch and tallow suits, and somehow
yes.
a candle. Oh, it didn't end well. No,
never a good idea. You know, if you're going to dance around candles, you know, please don't wear pitch and tallow and cover that with combustible leaves and other surfaces. You know, it was
indeed
sort of an accident made waiting to happen. But, you know, the cathedrals actually were sort of the mass media of those days. And that's where everybody came, and where you had the carvings and the pictures so they could, people who couldn't read could know the Bible stories and that kind of thing. And they were made to communicate these ideas. And so you did have people coming and seeing these carvings of werewolves and wild men and that sort of thing in these unexpected, you wouldn't expect that to be on cathedrals, but they were.
Right.
So they did have some idea in their minds, but they must have been astounded to hear it coming from the native peoples who did not.
Oh, that must have been astonishing indeed. And I'm thinking of the Ugly Horse Ranch and what you stumbled on while you were doing an article for Horseman Magazine, Western Horseman Magazine, yes, and taking photos. And you found something strange in a square concrete block?
Yeah, I'm walking through their
in
driveway.
In Jefferson County?
Yeah, it was in Jefferson County, exactly, and not that far out of the Kettle Moraine State Forest, where so many sightings of both things have occurred. But there's this concrete block, and it had carved faces that really reminded me of the faces of these medieval different gargoyle sorts of things that from cathedrals. And I'd been on a summer art study in Europe, you know, as part of my education, and had been back there once or twice, and two of the sides looked like what you consider a classic, you know, little horned pan or devil type thing, and the other two looked like werewolves. I mean, there was just no way around it. Yeah, and I was shocked, and I said, "Where did you get this?" And he said, "Oh, there were some buried in my backyard, right on the lot line, and I dug them up, and you know, put one here in the driveway."
And you determined that. Yeah, go on. I'm sorry to interrupt.
Oh, that's okay. So I just thought that it was interesting that this block turned up with these carvings on it that somebody had gone to a great deal of trouble to bury. Your mind can just kind of go wild. Like, you wonder if they had, why would somebody bury these cool objects? They are located around, after I wrote about it, people said, oh, we have one too. And it was buried. And there's actually a house on the outskirts of town that was using them for kind of porch supports that they had, you know, the porch posts were set onto a couple of them. Yeah.
Yeah. And there were altogether something like four or more, and right?
I knew of. Right.
Right.
I went back there, and he dug one up right in front of me and gave it to me.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
That is amazing. That's amazing. And I remember, but I cannot find it in my notes, some possible correlation with cornerstones for a Masonic lodge. Is that,
well,
does that ring a bell for you?
The thing was that it turned out that each one of these places that had these stones, the neighbor directly behind the Ugly Horse Ranch, and all of the other ones were at one time or another master masons.
Oh, for heaven's sake.
From sort of the same time frame, and the original Masonic Lodge burned down around that back in that time frame, and they built a new, beautiful, large brick one in this little teeny-weeny town of Palmyra.
For heaven's sake.
But something had to have happened to the original posts and post holders, which are sort of a staple of you know, Masonic lodges that I don't really know exactly what they're used for. But my theory was that perhaps they were, because they ended up in the homes of these grandmasters, that they came from that original lodge, and maybe they just thought they looked cool and each took one home.
My gosh, think about that. Kind of like, oh, it's a party. Who gets to take home the centerpiece? Oh, what do you
we'll
think?
We'll never know. You know, we'll never
right.
know. But those, it is fact that those men were, and that was all very openly written up in a file in the local library. So it wasn't like I had to do any deep searching for that. It was all right there.
Oh, gosh, isn't that great when you're looking for something, you have an idea, and it just falls into place right in front of you. I love that. Well, Linda, we're going to sort of wrap up here for this part of the hour. And when we come back, I see a couple of questions in chat. Would you like to take some questions?
Sure, I'd be glad to.
Okay, fantastic. Okay, everybody, thank you so much for joining us. We're talking to Linda S. Godfrey, with or without the S. She's got one Facebook page with the S and one without it, but she's the same person and the same amazing writer. And when we come back, I want to talk about this theater of the mind, the simulated werewolf hunt that amazed and angered listeners in Grand Rapids, Michigan. And that's a personal favorite of mine because I lived in Grand Rapids for a decade. So when we come back, I think we're going to take some questions and hit upon the theater of the mind in Grand Rapids, Michigan.
You're listening to IRN, the Inception Radio Network, Chicago, Illinois.
Forget what's coming up tonight, did you? Hi, Inception Radio Network listeners. This is Amanda. Never miss that interview you were looking forward to or the show on your favorite topic. Follow IRN on Twitter, I_R_N, and get reminders about the evening's live shows as well as fun and important updates throughout the week. That's I_R_N, and never miss a great show again. Hello, Inception Radio Network listeners. This is Amanda. Remember, you can take your Inception Radio shows on the go. Just download the Inception Radio Network app for your iPhone, iPad, or Android smartphones and access live shows, past shows, guest lineups, and much more. Just visit the iTunes Store or the Google Play Marketplace and download it today for free.
Hi, can you hear my voice? Imagine how many other people can hear it too. If you have advertising needs, then look no further. The Inception Radio Network currently has openings for on-air advertisements and radio show sponsorships. Given any thought to your target demographic? Inception has you covered there, too. Advertising on a network gives you multiple opportunities to advertise on a wide variety of radio show broadcasts, and we have one to fit every advertising need. You know, in recent years, internet radio has exhibited a phenomenal listener growth. An Arbitron Edison survey shows that online radio boosts at least 33 million unique visitors each week and 54 million each month. And that number amazingly continues to grow. And these listeners are a part of many businesses' core demographics. And surveys have shown that internet radio listeners are far more likely than regular radio listeners to spend money on a whole range of activities. You know, internet listeners vote, they dine out, eat fast food, and they grab a cup of coffee. And here's the interesting one. They buy items online at a much higher rate than all other market segments combined. Internet radio also enables businesses to connect with consumers during work hours, where increasingly more lifestyle decisions are being made. Advertise with the best. The Inception Radio Network offers competitive advertising rates to fit just about anyone's advertising budget. Stop by today at www.inceptionradionetwork.com or call us toll-free at 1-888-919-2355. Get the word out. Get results with the Inception Radio Network.
Looking for a cure for boredom? Never worry. IRN's interactive website introduces a number of ways to pass time while you listen to your favorite show. Choose anything from the IRN Chat Lounge, Game Lounge, Video Lounge, or the Mood Lounge. These fun, exciting features let you chat in real time with fellow listeners, view live skywatches, play daily posted online games, or pick a show based on topic. The choices are endless, so use your time wisely by keeping it all on IRN.
Don't have a computer? Is your internet connection down? Don't worry. Use your trusty cell phone or landline and call into our listen line at 401-283-6700 to listen to the Inception Radio Network 24/7. Again, that call-in number is 401-283-6700. For the Inception Radio Network, I am MJ.
Howdy, this is Joe Mars. I'm inviting you to tune in to Epic Voyages, 8 p.m. Central, 9 p.m. Eastern, Monday nights, right here on Inception Radio Network. To find out more about Epic and how you can become a member, visit epicvoyagers.com. That's EPICVOYAGERS.com.
Here we are, guys, back with Linda Godfrey and her fantastic stories from, well, Beast of Bray Road is one, but Linda, you have many other titles beside that, yes?
I do. I think it's up to like 16 published books, including my first fantasy novel, which was co-published with my agent in New York. It's called God Johnson. If you go to lindagodfrey.com, that's my website, you'll find a page for God Johnson. You'll find a page for beast-related questions with frequently asked questions section and some other things. You'll find a books and bio page where you can see all my books are listed and find out a few other things that you probably never wanted to know about me, but they're there anyway. and you can get the Twitter feed. You can find me on Twitter and sign up for me on Twitter that way too. And I do try to be pretty active on Twitter, although I've been a bit lax lately with both of those things because I've got a looming deadline coming with Penguin Random House for my next book, which is it's due August 1st. So I'm in crunch time.
My gosh. Do we get to have a sneak preview of the title?
Well, the title is still being worked out, so I can't give you that. But let me just say that it has to do with the stranger side of strange creatures, which, you know, is sort of an oxymoron because, I mean, werewolves and Bigfoot, face it, most people already think those are plenty strange, but then you get into things like you start noticing after so many years that, yep, even though it's a minority, there's quite an unexpected percentage that present with either UFOs or strange lights or actual paranormal phenomena such as morphing or vanishing or just very, very odd behaviors, that kind of thing, appearing in people's bedrooms, that sort of thing. So these are the stories of that, you know, small percentage that haven't necessarily made it into any of the other books. And it's, by the way, a lot of people think I wrote one book called The Beast of Bray Road about one creature, and nothing could be further from the truth, you know.
Yes, that's what I wanted to go to here.
Yeah, it's a long range. The first book came out in 2003, and as I said, I'm up to 16. They aren't all on that. The last one, American Monsters, covers all types of creatures seen across the USA. You know, so it's a broad spectrum brush, and I do spend time in the field. You know, it's not like I'm just sitting in a chair all day by any means.
Right. Not the academic in the ivory tower. You're in the field. Yes.
I try to do both, actually. I try to,
they don't have to be mutually exclusive. No, they don't. Now, are you ready for some questions from chat?
Sure. Bring them on.
We can do a couple and then we can go back into some of the material. But I have one here from Sky33 in chat. And her question is, when these creatures are reported, are there UFOs reported around the same time? We touched on that briefly, but if you could elaborate.
Sometimes there are. The greatest percentage, now I think it happens more frequently with Bigfoot than with the man wolf or the dog man, but there are more Bigfoot sightings than dog man. So you'd sort of expect that in the first place. It so happens that I just recently for the book that I'm working on had a really great Bigfoot sighting that occurred some years ago in Chicago. And it was quite an unusual and prolonged sighting.
Wow.
And when I went and looked up the correlating date, and it was also unusual in that he really pretty much knew the date. Most of the time when something was a while ago, people aren't very sure when it happened, but this guy had some reasons that he was. And I was able to find a really amazing UFO sighting that happened within a couple of blocks at almost the same exact time, where neither witness was aware that the other thing had happened, but they both were there, you know, at the same time. So it's more usual that there would be strange lights, like orb-type things, round
orbs,
drifting around, or sometimes basketball-sized globes of light will appear, and then people will see a Bigfoot or a dog man or something else, you know. So, and the thing is, I was just going to say there are researchers who will just say, well, that can't be, so I'm going to ignore that, or that's erroneous. And I've probably done that once or twice, you know, in my career where I've thought, well, that doesn't seem to have anything to do with it, and it might not have, you know, I might have disregarded it. But the longer time goes on, the more I realize these are things that witnesses I'm judging to be completely sincere and credible as far as their creature report goes, and then how can you say, well, all of a sudden, no, you're no longer credible. I can't believe this part. How can you make that separation?
And, exactly.
And when you leave those in, you start noting that there are correlations between lots and lots of encounters that you had missed before. You know, and if you don't look at all of the factors in any one account, then you're really just kind of seeking to confirm your own biases rather than conducting an actual investigation, because you're looking only for what you want to see and not what the witness is actually reporting.
Right, and that's just, well, lousy forensics. And back to the orbs for just one second. Would you care to, I'm slightly off topic here, but what's your take on orbs?
Well, there are orbs and there are orbs.
Right.
You know, I mean, lots of the times, people will send me photos, and so many of the times, especially if it's something taken outdoors at night with a flash, and you'll see all these little things, any little insect will reflect that light, and because your camera lens is round, you're going to get what looks like this round light thing. And a lot of the right. times, it's specks of dust, it's insects. After a while, you can kind of get to know. Sometimes you'll just see them, and they're doing things that it would be impossible for a light reflection to do. You know, and then you know you've got something different, or you can get... And anybody who's looking at these kinds of things should go online and familiarize themselves with the type of camera anomalies that appear to be orbs or appear to be shafts of light or appear to be certain common forms that appear and how you can tell the difference.
Good point.
Yeah, I mean, you may not be an expert at it, but it will allow you to rule out a certain number of them. So, you know, there are things that turn out to be camera reflections and refractions, and then there are things that are unexplainable, you know, and I've seen both kinds.
Right, right. It's one thing to have them as artifacts on film from a camera shot, but then apparently the first person and up close and personal is quite striking, and there are folks who have experienced that.
Oh, yeah, yeah. There are people who, especially at places where they're famous for light anomalies, like, say, the Paulding or Waters Meet Lights in Michigan is one, the Brown Mountain Lights in Texas.
Right.
I mean, there are lots of places that are famous for so-called, quote, spook lights. But, for instance, the Waters Meet or Paulding Lights in Michigan, just over the border from Wisconsin. Nice. I've been there. I had to write about them for Weird Wisconsin for the Weird US series. I co-authored
right.
Weird Wisconsin, and I also authored Weird Michigan and a couple of sequels to those. So I have branched out and looked at other types of phenomena too. And the thing is, it almost always turns out this way. There's one type of light that's very legendary. It's supposed to be it's supposed to be near a railroad track, and it's supposed to be an old conductor swinging his lamp. And there's a
wow.
certain type of lights that I have good friends who've gone up there with high power telescopes and stations, some people here and some people there, and have determined that some of the lights that people see are actually headlights and brake lights from a hill on a nearby highway. However, if you look over to the woods on either side, other people, and I've been on public radio shows up north where the whole show was about this, and people just called in the entire hour, and every single person said, no, there are other lights. They come out of the woods. They're red.
Wow.
They're like little orbs, or they flare up into bigger things. They come out of the woods. They go through our car. They turn off the car. They chase us. They go through formations. They shoot up in the sky. They do all these things that those headlights on the highway never could dream of doing.
Fascinating. So that's a complete anomaly. Wow. And I'm thinking, of course, of will-o'-the-wisps and
right.
you know, it's not fireflies. Right, right. Yes, exactly. But when they behave so very differently than anything people have witnessed as a natural phenomena, it's got to go into the something else file.
Yeah, it kind of does. And I do go into these things quite a bit in my new book. And there's also something called the rolling mist and other types of mists that are seen frequently, some that will appear on camera but not to the naked eye. I've got quite a few of these that will be documented in this book too, and encounters by hunters and actually sheriff's deputies with these strange mist-like entities.
Wow. Oh, my gosh. Yeah, sheriff's deputies. That's the thing. You know, we are conditioned, and I think there's some accuracy here, to think that when law enforcement sees something and speaks of it, they're in the bailiwick of trained witness.
And right.
Yes.
Right. And there are. And I recently actually had two sheriff's deputies from somewhere in Wisconsin. I cannot reveal their identities, of course. But they came to me because they have, between the two of them, over the past, I don't know, 4 or 5 years, something like that, seen a total of, in their third shift, driving around, 4 different upright wolf-like creatures and at least 2 Bigfoots and 1 anomalous mist. Yeah, and they can't.
Oh, for heaven's sake.
Nobody wants to hear that upline, you know, in their profession.
Right.
And their official line, if they do get a call from somebody about some of these things, is to go there, look around, and then officially report, "I went there and didn't see anything."
Right.
So, and I've been waiting for years to get a law enforcement professional to admit that to me, because it's what I've always suspected.
You've got to get somebody who's retired, right? Is that the way to do it? But then we've got pension issues, maybe.
As long as you keep them anonymous, and I do keep people anonymous if they request it, as long as I have their name and contact info to give to my publisher, so my publisher knows I didn't make them up, you know, and so I can contact them if I need to. But a lot of people, I'd much prefer that than to not have the report, because...
Of course.
Yeah, otherwise, you know, the database won't grow. If people are afraid to talk because they're going to be made fun of or lose their job, you know, or whatever, I'd much rather get that report.
Exactly. And that's, you make a point of that in your book that I loved, the idea that there would be such an incredibly huge support system if everybody who had had a sighting like this of some anomalous creature would just come forward. And, you know,
true.
I think that would take the sting out of, you know, the marginalization that people are afraid of.
It's really true. You know, and there are other people who maybe aren't even afraid of being made fun of, but they're actually in denial. It's sort of a post-traumatic stress syndrome where people are so shocked and their worldview is so overturned that they can't even admit it to themselves, much less others.
That makes sense. Right, exactly. The everything just shifts because they were not schooled in this. This is not what anybody says is on our earth and on our planet and goes on.
Right. Right. Yeah, and Carole, I can't tell you how many letters I get from people saying, "I thought I was the only one. I thought I must be nuts."
Oh, and that's sad.
I was so glad to see or to hear, you know, I saw one of your books or I heard you on the radio, to find out that there are others just changed the world for me and made me know that it wasn't just me. And there's this tremendous sense of relief. And they'll write to me and say, "I just need to tell one person who knows I'm not crazy." And I'm like, "Tell me whatever it is, I can guarantee you I've heard crazier." You know, that's really true. And I mean, there are times, it's not like I buy everybody's story. I mean, I have my certain ways. Working 10 years for the newspaper, interviewing 1 to 3 people per week on various topics, you get a good sense for how to do that. And not that I'm infallible. I'm sure that there are people who have, you know, slipped 1 or 2 through. But there are things I look for. And, you know, occasionally I'll get one, not very often, really, but once in a while I'll get one that doesn't pass the smell test, or that I'll kind of look into it and find something's not right. You know, and I have my ways of doing that too. So, and the internet has made that so much easier. You can check things out just way, way quicker than you could before, you know, when
exactly.
I was doing this.
It's an entirely different world. I've come across a question in chat that's a really interesting one that actually I might have asked myself. It's, how do you feel about being directed professionally toward this subject as a journalist? It probably, as this Derhoof who asks the question says, I'm sure it wasn't your first choice. Why were you energized by the subject?
Oh, right. Yeah. Well, I didn't think it was going to be. I did not think that it was going to be a lifelong quest. Honestly, you know, I didn't. I thought it was a fascinating local story. I thought at the time that it was either going to be folklore in the making or that there was some dangerous animal around that people had a right to know about. You know, if I lived out in the area where these sightings were taking place and I had small children or animals, I would want to know that a dangerous predator was around, you know, so I could take a little more care.
Absolutely.
And that was, and it was kind of, you know, it was just sort of amusing, and I just thought people would have fun. My editor and I thought people would have fun with it and forget about it in 2 weeks. I had no
little did you know.
I had absolutely no clue. You know, I mean, within weeks, Inside Edition came and Sci-Fi's New In Search Of and every radio station across the USA. It was just insane. And then it never stopped. Now, I wrote for the newspaper for 10 years. And then it was a couple more years before I wrote my first book. And really, in all that time, I wasn't even planning to write a book. I was just, I felt like as long as people continued to send me there, and people were finding me, you know, this is before everybody had email and the internet was kind of new to everyone. And they were finding me at the newspaper and writing me there or just sending, you know, letters to Elkhorn, Wisconsin, and they'd get to me somehow. But
I
they
can't
were,
resist this. Linda,
I know, it seems like
down.
It must have been medieval times, but it was really only a couple of decades, yeah. And
right.
And so I'm thinking, if these people are going to such lengths to entrust me with their experiences and wanting them to be in the record, I have sort of an obligation to be what I kind of call the keeper of the lore. You know, and
oh,
so
that's beautiful.
I kept it, you know, and every once in a while I would write a very short update for just a column length for the newspaper. I think I maybe did a total of 5 in 10 years. The rest of the time I was writing on all the other normal subjects that you would write about, doing artwork and cartoons for the newspaper, that kind of thing. But I left the newspaper around the year 2000, 2001. And it occurred to me that in all that time, you know, it hadn't stopped. And I started wondering if I should write a book. And
wow.
And then what we first talked about, I began to realize how many inaccuracies were starting to creep into popular
right.
renditions of it. And I thought, I need to put this all down someplace, just where people can see what actually happened and see the effect it had in the town. I was thinking of it as much as a social study as to what happened, you know, with the reactions of the people and politicians got involved and, you know, bakeries
oh,
selling
right,
werewolf
right.
cookies and that sort of aspect and the local history. And on that basis, you know, the publisher, and actually it wasn't my first book. My first book, which is still available in some places too, was a local historic crime, true historic crime.
The Poison Widow, yes.
The Poison Widow, about a poison
right.
murderess who was actually living and involved in all the same areas where all these strange creature sightings were being. Not that she had any connection, but
no, right.
it was just so odd that it was the same territory, and it was a nationally known incident and trial back in the 1920s when it was going
and
on.
That,
and it was
and that in... I just want to just interrupt because that involves a delicious bit of synchrony, doesn't it? Because you were looking for something connected with that story.
Well, I was actually looking, when I found the Poison Widow story, I was looking for information on the Ku Klux Klan in the county in the 1920s because it was there was a big to-do with something happening in the county.
Ooh, yikes, I did not know that.
In a contemporary way, and so my assignment was to go back and kind of see what the county history of it was. And I'm looking in these old newspapers, and I'm seeing titles like Lewd, Lascivious Widow and Poison Lady, you know, does this and that. And so, of course, I'm reading them, you know, because they're very unusual titles. And I'm realizing there was this giant national story that had been locally completely swept under the rug because it was considered too sordid for the local people to even talk about. They couldn't even get a woman to serve on her trial jury because it was considered so terrible. that she had an affair with this college student that she and her husband were boarding at the time. And that was just considered just unbelievably lewd and lascivious and could not be talked about in polite society. And she and her husband had been pillars of the church. And she and the college boyfriend murdered her husband with strychnine.
Oh, my God.
And would have gotten away with it, except then he kind of decided he didn't want those four lovely children that she had. And so she tried to murder them in a just really horrendous, crazy way. It's stuff you couldn't make up. And
wow.
that was my first book, you know, and that was sold to a regional press that did a lot of local history. And again, it's called The Poison Widow, A True Story of Sin, Strychnine, and Murder.
It's no exaggeration.
Yeah, it was so
amazing.
But it was in all the same areas. And the funny thing was then I started finding things that in researching that story that also applied to the history of, for instance, the Jefferson County, you know, institution. They ended up in some of the same newspaper pages at times.
Right.
So,
as you were looking for her release date from prison, you stumbled upon,
yes.
And I cannot, word, memory does not serve, but it was the Trundage, that's not the right word, but you know.
I think you're talking about the wild man of...
The wild man.
Of Palmyra. Yeah, nobody still knows exactly what he was. They think it was a human that was some sort of immigrant that maybe spoke Russian, whose words they couldn't understand. But it hung around this general store that actually is about 5 miles from where I live, between Elkhorn and Whitewater, and would steal clothing that it found and steal food and was very, very hairy. But they think they called it, well, maybe a man who had let his hair grow, and who had a laughable assortment of weird articles of clothing to try and keep itself warm, which was really strange sounding too. And it actually got away from the sheriff who was trying to take it in, or the constable, whatever he was, who was trying to take it to the jail. It got away from him once and kind of floundered in the snow and was eventually caught again, stuck in the jail, and then nobody ever knew what happened to him.
Right. There was some physiological thing there where at some point it was kind of like, is this the dog man? Because he had purportedly very short legs and wasn't even able to run through the snow.
Yeah, he was very, very small in stature, but had this long growth of fur, you know, or hair.
Right, at this point.
And it just happened to be on the same page where the Poison Widow was lobbying for her release, even though she had confessed to the murders and the attempted murders. And I managed to find out that she was released and had a second family in Zion, Illinois, that knew nothing about what she did until I went and confronted, just I just kind of asked if they knew what their granny did, you know.
It
was very scary, and it happened to be in Zion, Illinois.
Perfect.
Which there's been
Something really cinematic about that. Oh my gosh!
Yeah.
Hey,
there's
a screenplay for you right there. Yes.
I've said very, very many times that, you know, it really would make a great, great movie, and I always picture Winona Ryder playing Myrtle.
Oh, perfect.
The poison.
Wow.
You know? Yeah, there's some physical
she could
resemblance.
Do that.
It actually would be good because she was very attractive petite lady, beautifully dressed all the time, for her, considering that she was, you know, kind of a little country girl. They always described her clothing in the courtroom, and I researched that for 6 years. I had 500 pages of court documents. I found original still living witnesses who were in their 80s and 90s by then, and did genealogy and actually went out to cemeteries and scraped mold off of headstones to try and figure things out. Yeah, so that was a very long labor of love, and it's very different from my other books, but I'm still really proud of it.
Oh, I like that. I like the idea. I am looking at two more topic-related questions from chat. Would you, and I can maybe mash up them into, are you ready?
Sure.
Okie doke. American Road Warrior, who's a mainstay of chat, asks this one. Is Linda familiar with the Paranormal Witness episode entitled The Wolf Pack? And if she is, could the wolf, werewolf entities in the Wolfpack episode be extraterrestrial? And if not, why, he says.
Well, that main Wolfpack incident was taken from my book, Real Wolfmen, True Encounters in Modern America. So, yeah, I'm the one who, I was the first contact with the witness. I did all the interviews. I wrote it up. It was in my book. And then the witnesses agreed to let me give their contact information to the TV show when they called me. And you would actually not know from watching that TV show. There's a super brief little takeout clip from when I was on Sean Hannity America right in the beginning of that show. But for those people who aren't familiar, there were a husband and wife, to make a long story short, sitting on their front porch, turned on their yard light to see themselves being stalked and flanked by five upright wolf-like creatures that were 7 feet tall. They could tell by them going under a certain door that they knew the height of. They were 20 feet away. They were flanking them, three on one side, two on the other. And they managed to back into the house and were sort of trapped in there all night long.
Wow. And
it was Yeah, it was just this really crazy thing. And that's in, I have witness sketches by the husband and the wife in Real Wolfman, True Encounters in Modern America, and they're full-blown true story of what happened. Now, Paranormal Witness did a pretty good job, I think, of representing it, but like any of the TV shows, there were some things that were exaggerated and hyped a little. There was no werewolf coming in the window, or she never even dreamed that a werewolf was smashing through the window. They did not take axes to bed. There were no great footprints that looked like they should have had casts made from them. There were just impressions in the grass, you know, things like that. So everything was hyped up a notch like they usually do when there's a dramatization. Otherwise, it was pretty pretty well represented, I thought. Now, the reason that people may be thinking there is a link to UFOs is that there were a number of light phenomena, which basically to Shelley and her husband and son, they had thought of as just some kind of odd lights in the woods. It wasn't like they saw a big UFO or anything. Now, that part about the lights was really actually dramatized more than the family emphasized it to me. And I think the TV show chose to dwell on that a little bit more in order to seem to give it something of a background, so it wasn't just like these creatures popped out of nowhere.
I'm not sure
that there's any real connection. They were present on the property before this happened, but I don't think to the degree that was quite portrayed. So it was true. I can't say whether I think these are aliens. A lot of people think that all of these dogmen come from another dimension, a parallel world. There are many different ways of looking at it. Maybe not even extraterrestrial aliens. There are also supposed to be aliens that, you know, come from these other places or even inside the Earth, subterranean passages. I just note all the different theories, and I haven't found one yet that I can say, yes, I know, this is it for sure. I will say that they, like the Bigfoot, have weight and strength and seem to be very interested in procuring deer meat and dogs and even cats to eat, like Bigfoot too. So they eat, mm-hmm. they leave footprints, they have weight, they do things, they interact, they're not completely apparitions. That much can be said. But I don't know that there's any way to say with any amount of certainty, whether they're otherworldly or not. But I do explore that idea in my new book, I will say.
Give us the title of that new book, Linda.
I wish I could.
Oh, that's right. That's the one that's a work in progress. Okay.
Yeah,
well, the title.
You'll recognize it because it'll have something about, you know, unknown creatures, lights, maybe the word portals. I'm not sure if that's going to make it in there. It might be the strange side of strange creatures, something like that.
All we need to really look for is your name. That's pretty simple. That cuts right to the chase, shall we say. Yes, yes, yes. Oh, well, you know, does anybody else really do what you do?
Oh, sure. There are lots of other researchers. There are, I think, more and more the internet and Facebook. Facebook groups. There are lots more people who are, because of self-publishing, who can have the chance to have their work put out there in print, you know, which is a good thing. Lots of radio shows, lots more people out there looking, and it's becoming a lot more known. I will say that for many years, there were very, very few people who were interested in even thinking about an upright unknown canine. And most mm-hmm. of the people looking for Bigfoot were just saying, well, these are just a form of Bigfoot with a snout. They were calling it the snouted Bigfoot, which totally ignores
that one.
Yeah, the thing is, it totally ignores the fact that the rest of the creature is nothing like a primate. It's got, forearms and legs. The forearms and the hind limbs are those of a dog. They walk on their toe pads like a canine. They've got the pointed ears, the long snout, the fangs, claws, not, you know, broad nails like the Bigfoot has. They're totally different structurally. The same difference you'd expect between, say, a hyena and a chimpanzee. You know, they're that different.
Wow.
And they behave differently, too. So, very different creatures. And for a long time, you know, the dog man just wasn't getting any respect, which was okay with me. I was just getting the stories and writing them and doing the best I could to research as many as I could without having... I often note I do not have funding to, you know, search the world for them, but what I could get to, I always have. I've always done field work from the very beginning, from the very first chicken in the ditch episode.
I love that. Not chicken in a basket, chicken in a ditch. Yes.
Chicken in the ditch. Yeah.
Yeah. Yep.
I don't always emphasize that in my books because I'd rather the focus be on the witnesses and the research and the other things. But I've always been out there. On site whenever I can.
This is terrific. I think that's what I mean because, or what I meant when I posed that question of who else does this. It seems to me that you're the go-to person in the field rather than just, you know, trying to suss out and collate some sort of somebody else's already printed and established research. And that's inspiring.
Well, you know, and it's okay. I mean, all of us who write these sorts of books, well, when you want another example or you see that somebody else has found just what you're looking for, I mean, there's nothing wrong with having some other, with permission, of course, you know, in comparing other examples to what you found. But and there's also a place for people who do collate different types of creatures and just give brief descriptions of them and that kind of thing. It's, to me, I always say it's a big tent universe. There's room for all different types of books, all different types of research, all different types of researchers, you know, from those who spend all their time at the library looking for ancient newspaper reports to those mm-hmm. who are only in the field. There's no one, in my book, there's no one right or wrong way to do it. There's no one right or wrong way to look for Bigfoot or the dog man because we don't know, you know, we don't have these creatures to perfectly study. Many people have, you know, had the fortune to see them and may have more information than others, but that still doesn't mean that the final verdict is in on there's just one way to do it, and anybody else who does it another way doesn't know beans and ought to be drummed out of every Facebook group and that kind of thing. You know, there's a lot of unnecessary dissension that I think if everybody would just be accepting of how other people are working, it might all contribute to a larger picture someday.
Exactly. Open-minded and accepting. And since we kind of tread upon this territory just slightly a second ago, I want to ask you another question that appears here, asked by Derhoof in chat. Let's go paranormal. He says, has she ever had a personal paranormal experience, an entity, a haunting?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, do you want to share it?
Well, which one? You know,
you decide.
As I said, this isn't something that I go into in my books a lot because I like the focus to be on other people. I don't want it to be me, you know, me, that sort of thing.
Right, well, we have you cornered here, so but if you want to share, that would be great.
Well, you know, I have talked about my encounter with what I'm pretty sure was Bigfoot because someone with me saw it. We smelled it, and I saw whatever it was, ripped a 35-foot long, 7 to 8 inch diameter living oak, fresh oak, not cut, not woodpecker, peckered, to be rotten or anything like that, wow, off of a living oak tree, and dropped it 40 feet below down into a kettle right in front of me. Really, it was literally right in front of me, in front, wow, of my eyes.
Oak and tree, that's hard wood. And by kettle, you don't mean the bowl kettle, you mean the geographical kettle?
The geographical kettle, this is like a bowl-shaped, a series, huge tracks of bowl-shaped depressions left by the last glacier. We have, mm-hmm, a lot of state, there's the Kettle Moraine State Forest that runs from the southern part of the state way up to north of Milwaukee, up that way, lots and lots of space in there, and lots of places where nobody goes down in those things because they're treacherous, they're viney, they're full of, you know, plants and things. But this happened right in front of me, and I have lots of pictures of that's on my blog. If you go to lindagodfrey.com and scroll back to 2012 blog entries, you can find it there. And it's also in my, I think I put it in Real Wolfman, or is it in American Monsters? I can't remember. One or the other.
but it's on your blog. That's great.
But it's in there. But I have seen, when I was researching, I had to drive all over Michigan and Wisconsin to do the photography for the Weird U.S., for the Barnes & Noble books, Weird Wisconsin and Weird Michigan. And in each of those states, I just happened to see an apparition in the place where it was supposed to be with my bare eyes. And each time I was so shocked, I couldn't get the camera. I just forgot about taking the picture. I was holding the camera, waiting for something to happen. And it did. And I couldn't believe my eyes. And it happened in two different places. One was in Sparta, Wisconsin, and the other was in Manistee, Michigan. And
Manistee, Michigan. Hold on. I spent many summers as a child there in a cottage in Portage Lake. My
grandfather.
Yeah. Yes, my grandfather was a vice president of the Northeastern Manistee Railroad, et cetera, et cetera. And my father was born there. And the cottage was actually near a place that was named Spirit of the Woods, Wiketiwa.
Mm.
Had I only known.
Yeah, this was down, and I found this out. I didn't know that anything was haunted there, but what I liked to do when I got into town was find out if there was a local historian I could talk to. And I did find such a gentleman right away, and he pointed me down to this brick building downtown, and it was supposed to be haunted by a young man from around the 1900 era called Basement Billy, because he died of diphtheria in that building, and supposedly haunted the basement. There were a couple of other ghosts too, and the whole story of that is in Weird Michigan. You can see the whole thing. It's titled Weird Michigan Sees Basement Billy.
And fantastic.
And it was a white light about the size of a basketball that appeared. We were in total darkness. The owner had no idea I was coming. We were in the basement. And we decided to stand in pitch blackness and see if anything showed up. And this thing that was about maybe 10 feet away and 7 feet in the air, it was a very low ceiling, and it was right near the ceiling. And I couldn't believe my eyes. I turned to one side and then looked back, and it was still there. It had these kind of little projections on the side, kind of like triangular wings. And it seemed sentient. I had this feeling that it was expected.
Wow.
And I didn't like it. All I wanted to do was get out of there. And I asked the lady to turn the light back on. And she had seen it too, except it had more the form of a human, what she saw, which makes me wonder if these things are sometimes filtered through our brains and they interact with our consciousness to sort of form and manipulate what we see of them. And because I had less of a preconceived notion of what Basement Billy might look at, I'm thinking I saw the raw form, and she, having lived there and knowing what people saw and experienced its poltergeist effects and that sort of thing, had this more of a human notion. So,
that's fascinating. So in other words, the eye of the beholder has a lot to do here. And what just flashed on my mind is this interesting sociological, visual, physiological thing that just happened here in this country. The dress, the blue dress, are you aware of this? The dress that some people saw as blue and black and others saw as gold and white. Right.
Yeah.
And So that almost has a little fit in here. Perhaps it is something to do with our eyes and our brains.
Well, it might. And I think it's actually more to do with our minds and our consciousness, that there seemed to me that there was another intelligence in that basement with us, and that it was interacting with us somehow. And this isn't just my idea. You'll find a lot of researchers are coming more and more to this sort of idea. It kind of gets back to the idea of those dogmen standing up and staring at people. They feel there's an interaction there. There's an undefinable, unnameable interaction happening. And, I mean, almost the only way to say it is from, you know, your consciousness to this other entity's consciousness. And some people feel that it is manipulative, and that they can influence us to see what they want to see. And I'm not saying that every Bigfoot sighting or every creature sighting is that, but I think there are times when that can be the case, you know, and when that is happening. And if you're seeing something like a globe of light, perhaps that, or an orb is interacting with you and chasing you in a woods, maybe you're interacting in ways that your conscious mind is not aware of, or that we really don't know too much about, most of us anyway, other than perhaps there are people who are trained to this. But yeah, I've had several experiences in my day. I'll just put it that way. It's not like I've never had these things happen.
And did you come away with a feeling of, I can't pursue this because there is no answer, or how did this inspire you?
I'm not sure I quite understand what you're asking.
Oh, in other words, sometimes I think I seem to get the sense that folks will say, okay, it's too much, I cannot pursue it because there is no there's no, and I know in Beast of Bray Road you mentioned that sometimes you're comfortable with allowing a mystery to just remain a mystery.
Yeah, and it's not because there's no there. It's because it's because there's nowhere else to go with the search. You know what I'm saying?
It may be that, or
in some cases, you know, like when it comes to say the skin changers, there's things I consciously do not want to know, not because there's no there. It's because I don't want to know if there is a there. It's beyond the scope of what I've decided I want to do, which is just to figure out and categorize and document what people see, and sort it out, put some kind of a context and structure to it. That's the role that I see myself in. And other writers and researchers may have entirely different goals. You know, there may be some that are dying to know, if an actual solid flesh and blood werewolf exists. I personally still don't believe that humans physically change all their corpuscles and atoms and parts of their body into physical different species. You know, I still don't believe that. I think that if there's a manifestation, that we're dealing with a force we don't understand, but it's not
it's not at a cellular level, right?
It's not. That's a good way to put it. It's not at a cellular level or anything like that. It's something different, you know, that we don't get. And that's, you know, what that may be is just sort of beyond my ken. I'm not a physicist, you know, I'm not a microbiologist. I'm not someone who specializes in learning magic rituals or anything like that. That's for other people who have those interests.
Right. That's a whole different area.
Right.
Do you want to talk about the doggone just a bit? Getting into the ancientness?
Well, I see we're coming up where we don't have a lot of time, and that is a big topic.
It is. It's an entirely different. Well, it's not different because it's totally connected, because I got it from your book, but it is. It goes to a whole different. I don't want to say mythology. That's not quite right. But how about King John? This was something I did not know anything about, that King John of England was accused of werewolfery.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, it was, if you lived in Europe, you know, during those centuries, the Middle Ages, medieval times, you believed in werewolves and you believed that anyone could be a werewolf and that you were probably trained to look to see if your neighbor had unibrow or hairy palms.
Right. Or worst of all, as you mentioned, the thing you couldn't tell. Well, until you couldn't tell this till you had killed the suspect, the hair growing inside the body, right?
Right. Yeah. It was, I mean, it was just really horrific and dreadful. And these trials were constant and ongoing in public. And everybody believed it. I mean, it was just common accepted fact in those days. And, you know, I will say with the Dogon people, just to mention that in case anybody's wondering briefly, because we don't have much time.
Sure, sure.
This is an indigenous people in Africa who somehow have this, their religion includes knowledge about Sirius the Dog Star, that they shouldn't have, you know. It has,
right, way pre-science.
Right, right, with the number of moons, and it's very complex to go into, but it's just another amazing thing that I included, because culturally you can go back in any part of the world and you'll find these ancient connections with canines. You know, there are certain areas of China where the people's oldest beliefs are that they were descended from a special sacred canine. And you can still see that too. And that happens in Native Americans. There are Native American traditions too, especially around Canada. And you can see this in China. There's something called they still have festivals where the women will put two little kind of funny, shape their hair up into two funny little buns that look like dog ears on top of their heads. You know, it's really, yeah, it's a worldwide, very ancient connection that we have with all things canine. And, you know, something that I've tried to think, why do people see these upright canines? That's been my other overarching question. The reason that I keep doing it is because people keep seeing them. And there is a deep, wide connection in all of ancient human prehistory that tells me that people are still seeing them and continually seeing them because there is some big connection. And whether I find it or somebody else does, I see myself as just putting together things that might be a little part of the puzzle someday that somebody else may take and go, oh, okay, she found this, and now we can see, because of what we know, these two things. Whoops, are we still here?
I think we're still here. Are we still here?
Okay.
No, I kind of lost you for a second. Yes, it did get quiet.
Okay.
All right. I was waiting for a punchline, actually, but there is no punchline. Let's face it. We're just going to have to take this mystery probably with us. I think it's fascinating. I love the fact that you really put yourself away in this. You consider yourself a chronicler, and I see your work as a compendium for, as you put it, the researchers of the future. They can look back and say, hey, Linda S. Godfrey, or Linda Godfrey, if they want to forget the S, you know, did this, and we'll base, you know, her work on where we're going forward here. I love that.
Well, I would like it if it turned out that way, you know. And again, there's room for every type of writer in this subject. So I hope people keep looking and reporting, and especially those who have experiences. And by the way, if somebody does want to report an experience to me,
the easiest way is
please go to lindagodfrey.com. It's a WordPress blog, so there's no www. It's just lindagodfrey.com. You'll see where you can send it to me. And email is the preferred way, by the way. And you'll read about how to do that in there. So again, lindagodfrey.com. Everything is there, and you can find all the rest from it.
Fantastic. Well, this is amazing. Your body of work is... Oh, and speaking of bodies of work and speaking of things on the highway, what's the latest? Do you have the latest sighting that you could share with us of a or finding of some furry critter in your area?
Well, you know, I get things from all over the place. Uh-huh. The last known sighting of an upright canine on Bray Road, which is a different category, was probably a year ago from last February, and it was a pretty good sighting. But my most recent somebody laying eyes on it was from Calgary in Canada. Oh. When a woman, and this was on May 4th, I believe, and she came upon an upright 7-foot-tall dog man skulking behind her garage. She raises dogs, and they've had quite a bit of problems. Her daughter had a really good look at it last October in her car headlights when she pulled into the driveway, and it was right there. And they've heard it, and lots of incidents happening in this one particular area. But the most recent was just on the 4th of May. So that's the most
really recent. Oh, I love that.
Exactly. But I this is how it goes. I still get reports every week from somewhere.
Fascinating. And how do you find, what's the tone of most of them?
Most of them are just, I'm freaking out. I really want to talk to someone who won't think I'm crazy. Here's what happened to me.
Wow.
So it's always humbling. You know, I'm always very honored that people will confide in me and I take them seriously and try to listen.
Well, see, that comes across in not only your writings, but in your voice, the sincerity, the authenticity, you know, the openness. If I saw something weird, I wouldn't hesitate to tell you.
Well, thank you. I appreciate
You're welcome.
It's a big compliment.
Okay. Not that I have, you know, except looking in the mirror, but that's another story for another time. And so, no, my face isn't that furry. But I think we're about to wrap up here, but I'm not sure because this is like my first time doing this exactly solo. So I'm kind of looking to see what's going on. Is there, you know, this is a good time for you to tell us about your websites and all of your books.
Sure. And again, you can go to lindagodfrey.com and go to the books and bio page, and you'll find a list of books with links and things like that. I've got a really old website, beastofbrayroad.com, that's being dismantled, but there are still some useful things on there that's still in place, and weirdmichigan.com. Otherwise, I'm kind of transferring that stuff to lindagodfrey.com to different pages. I've got two different Facebook pages, Linda Godfrey, Linda S. Godfrey. Twitter, find me on Twitter. I like to do show up there quite a bit, and just if you had an experience and you'd like to share it, I would be very glad to hear it. Not just of the dog man, but I also, you know, I get reports of giant birds, other anomalous phenomena, you name it.
Fantastic. Linda, thank you so much for joining us here tonight. This was absolutely delicious. And I think that, you know, we all kind of got a good bite of the beast. The beast didn't get us, but, you know, that's kind of what we had in mind here. And thank you. And stay warm and keep your boots on and watch out when you're placing those wild chickens by the side of the road.
It was my pleasure. I really appreciate your having me. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Linda. It was our joy. Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
I'm going to kind of wrap up here just a bit, guys, and remind you that next week, same time, same place, IRN on at 9 o'clock till 11 o'clock Eastern Standard, Eastern Daylight Time, and 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, we're going to have Dr. Laurel Blythe Tag, interviewing our own Ken Cherry about his fantastic new book, The UFO Stephenville's Mark Slade Detective Story. So be here. Thank you so much for joining us. Good night.
Thank you for being with us tonight. Please join us again next Monday evening for Extraordinary Phenomena Investigations Council's Epic Voyages. I'm Roger Peacock for Epic. Until next time.